Well, what an honor and a privilege it is to be back with you again. And I want to thank Pastor Stacy and Casey for giving me this opportunity. God is good. Amen. We used to say all the time. I don't know if that's kind of fading out, but I think it's still true. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's still true, isn't it? Praise the Lord. Well, so many things have happened since prayer this morning. And then what I have in my notes that I'm kind of blown away again. So hang on, okay? I heard somebody say this the other day. It was actually a preacher, and he said, you know, you don't know what you don't know. You don't know what you don't know. Did you know that? That's kind of important, because if you think you know everything, then you can't be taught anything, and you can't learn anything, and you can't move further along in your life no matter what you're doing. If you think you know it all, there's not much help for you. But you don't know what you don't know. But you know that you need to know what you don't know, because what you know could determine your destiny and where you spend eternity. Is it Hosea who said, "My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge"? Another translation of that says, "My people are silenced for their lack of knowledge of knowing me." See, we as Christians, we shouldn't be silent, but we should be speaking and standing, as we were taught last Sunday, on the Word of God. Amen? You know, I was thinking about this. This is my Bible. But I was thinking about the Bible. You know, it's a book where the first two chapters talks about God the Father creating the heavens and the earth out of love, out of a father's heart, for a place. He had a dream of having a family of mankind. And so he creates this planet and the universe. And he puts everything in motion. And when everything is set, he creates man, or he makes man out of the dirt of the earth. And then he breathes his spirit, his breath of life, into that body. Scott was talking about it earlier. We're a three-part being. You are a spirit. You possess a soul, which is your mind, will, and your intellect. And you live in your earth suit. And when that earth suit expires, you have to leave this planet. But your spirit does not cease to exist. You go into eternity. So I was thinking about this book. So God creates this planet, and everything that he creates, he looks at and says it's good. And when he created man, he said it's very good. And then in the third chapter, there's a fall. What God had created and made good, man and Satan together destroyed that good. So in three chapters, where there's 66 books in the Bible, I don't know how many chapters, if you look in all 66 books, there are. But within the first three chapters, God's dream is crushed. Man, the man he created to fellowship with, has rebelled against him and said, "I want my way," with the help of the devil. the deceiver. Three chapters. And then the rest of this book is about the heart of God putting into motion a plan to win back his fallen man, his heart. God put everything on the line. See, most religions in the world require you to do something to earn your way into a right relationship with a higher being or with God. But Christianity, God puts that on himself. He takes responsibility for his fallen man. And the rest of the Bible is about that story, about this love story. To win back his fallen man. See, we were conceived in sin, the Bible says. There's no one that was born righteous. There's no one that was born good other than Jesus. And that was a special birth. But God put this whole plan in motion, and it was going to cost him everything to win you back, to redeem you, to buy you back. And this war started waging. In Genesis chapter 3, the devil calls, the Lord calls everybody together. He gets his man and his woman. He gets the serpent and he gets Satan there. And he starts saying, okay, guys, you've messed up. Here's the consequences. I didn't want it this way. But he speaks of hope to his man. He said, tells the man, you're going to have to work and sweat. And he tells the woman, you're going to, you know, go through childbirth. It's not going to be the way it could have been unless you're redeemed, as we talked about this morning. Hallelujah. And he tells Satan, this is hope for mankind. He tells Satan, he said, there's going to come one that's, you're going to strike at his heel, but he's going to crush your head. And he's going to be born of the seed of woman. Well, biology says that can't happen that way. That's why it was a miracle birth. But Satan hears this. He leaves the garden. Everybody leaves the garden. They're kicked out and have to go to, not that man didn't have work before while he was in the garden, but now he's got to go outside of the garden and work and sweat and toil. But Satan is trying to figure out, who is this that's going to crush my head? So this story of redemption begins. And there's this battle going on. Satan is trying to find this seed of woman to destroy it. And if you read the Old Testament in the light of that, a lot of things will make sense to you when God tells him to kill everybody. There's a battle going on. It's not just a fancy story. See, God created you when he made man. He created you so special because he made you in his image. You're so complicated. You're a spirit who has a soul who lives in a body, and those three work as one. And he made you in his image and his likeness, and God is a creator. You have so much potential. You have so much potential, and God has a plan and a purpose for your life. And Satan is still at war trying to destroy mankind. And I look around sometimes and I think, good Lord, is Satan winning? Where's the church? Where's the church? That's you and me, right? But there's this war going on. But God made you so special. And that's what Satan wants to destroy, is you. And you know, some of you, you didn't get a good start in life. Some of you come from broken homes. Some of you, your parents, one of your parents may have abandoned you. Some of you may have been abused and hurt, and you feel broken. That's because of the sin that entered the world. But you need to know that God put a plan in motion to redeem you, to buy you back. Oh, there's so many layers that make us up. So many experiences that we've been through. Bad, good. Satan desires to see the bad happen to you. He wants to ruin your life. He wants to think you can't be anything. But God's put this plan in motion to redeem you, to buy you back so that he could put his plans and purposes into your life and make you more than a conqueror. Here in this life, you're not going to have to fight a battle with Satan in heaven. He's not going to be there. But the work that Jesus did, he won the victory for us today. So there's this war that's going on. And so there's some things that you need to know. And this, you know, some of you know these things. Challenge parents to make sure your children know these things. Some of you may not know some of the things I'm going to talk about. But I think it's worth saying, because here's what I believe is going to happen today. I believe that there is going to be a seed sown in your heart that's going to produce salvation in your life. I've known people that I've shared the gospel with. I've preached when I was really young in high school. I was preaching in a church and to some of my classmates. And I thought, well, they'll never get saved. A year or two later, they're saved and serving the Lord. And some of them, I almost fell over backwards. Now, I don't know if it was the message I preached, but I preached and I prayed for those people. But I do believe a seed was planted. And there's seed that are going to be planted in you concerning salvation, concerning healing, concerning who God is. So I would ask you, what do you believe about God? What do you believe about God? Do you know what you believe about God? Do you know? Do you know what you believe about God? Well, let me tell you a couple of things. One, Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It's not complicated. If you believe this, you won't have any trouble believing the rest of the Bible. I wish I had a bigger amen. In the beginning, God. Like the one student who went, he was a Christian, and he went to the Jewish university. He had a couple of degrees already. And he thinks, well, I'm a Christian. I'll go and participate. I'll take some courses at this Jewish school. He gets in there. He's the only one in khakis and Dockers and, you know, his Izod shirt. This was back in the late 60s, early 70s. And everybody else is dressed in white and black. And he came to find out also that they all could quote the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, by heart. And so the professor, the rabbi, comes into the class and he calls out one of the students, Eli, stand up, quote Genesis. So Eli starts. In the beginning, God, the professor says, stop. Start over. In the beginning, God, stop, the professor says, start over. In the beginning, God, stop. Seven times he did this. And then he said, listen, if you don't believe that, then this class is not for you. If you're here to get a degree, and he said some bad things, he said, you can leave this class right now. In the beginning, God. Do you believe that? Do you know what you believe about your God? He created the heavens and the earth. Runs right into smack dab in the face of a theory called evolution. And some of you are trying to work evolution into your Christian beliefs. Why? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Amen? Settle it. Settle it. Be free. Amen? Set yourself free by believing the word of God. There's something else you need to know. Hebrews 9:27. Oh, somebody knows it. I got two versions here. I want to see which one I want to read. As it is appointed for men to die once, but after this, the judgment. Let me read that again. And as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this, the judgment. See, there's coming a judgment day. Another version says, every human being is appointed to die once and then to face God's judgment. So here's the truth. Yes, you were born. You might not even wanted to have been born. Doesn't matter. You were. God has a plan and a purpose. Never let the devil tell you that your life is not worth living. He has a plan and a purpose for your life. But you need to know that one day you will die. I don't think we can find anyone that was alive 150 years ago. They're all gone. You and I will one day die, and then we will go before God. Revelation 20:10 says this. The devil who deceived them, the nations, was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. See, there's coming a judgment day that we are all going to have to stand before the Lord. Gosh, I haven't heard this preached in about 40 years in the church. It's been a while. This is Revelation 20. This is spoiler alert, okay? I've read the back of the book. I know how it ends. God wins. Sorry if you haven't gotten there yet, but it's true, okay? This is at the end. This is when the whole show is wrapping up. See, we're in day six of God's creation. We're at the end of day six. Things are about to wrap up here. Hallelujah. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. Hallelujah. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. See, the lake of fire was intended for Satan and his fallen angels, not for mankind. But if you don't know Jesus as your Redeemer, then you'll die and go into eternity as an outlaw. I'm going to say that again. The lake of fire is prepared for Satan and his followers. If you're not born again, if you're not bought with the blood of Jesus, if you haven't come to Jesus and said, "Be my Savior, be my Lord." If you haven't been born again, when you die, the second you die and enter into, when your spirit enters into eternity, you're going to go into it as an outlaw. And you know what's going to happen? You're going to be arrested and incarcerated. And they're going to send you to the lake of fire. These are things you need to know, right? You need to know this. Your children need to know this. This is a call to action. Find the Redeemer. Call upon the name of the Lord that you might be saved. Someone says, "What about those who believe?" 2 Corinthians 5:10 tells us, "For we believers must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad." So believers get to go before the judgment seat of Christ. Those who don't know Jesus as their Redeemer will have to stand before the great white throne of judgment. And Scott, you jumped on that during communion. Romans 2:16 says, "So this judgment will be revealed on the day when God, through Jesus the Messiah, judges the hidden secrets of people's hearts. And their response to the gospel I preach will be the standard of judgment used in that day." In other words, what you believe about the gospel, what you've done with the gospel, will determine where you will spend eternity. You need to know this. Amen. You need to know that there is a God and that he is the creator of heaven and earth and that his plan was to have a family. And man rebelled against that plan along with Satan. And then there was consequences which caused the fall, which caused the sin, which brought about the hurt, the rejection, the fear that some of you are dealing with in your life today. But there is a Redeemer that can redeem you from that. Hallelujah. I've got in my notes, what's the most important thing? What's the most important thing? Or let me ask you this way. What is mankind's greatest enemy? Mankind's greatest enemy. I can't get on YouTube without somebody addressing it from the world standpoint. Mankind's greatest enemy is death. And every day I get on the internet, somebody's trying to tell me, sell me, how I can do something to make my life better, to live longer. Christian's greatest enemy, now this might be different and I shouldn't go here, but a Christian's greatest enemy is lack of knowledge of the Word of God in your mouth. Let the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, deal with you on that. And we'll preach that another time, right? So if mankind's greatest enemy is death, then what is mankind's, what's the most important thing that's opposite of death would be eternal life. And that's what Jesus offers you, eternal life. But you have to receive it. You have to do something about that. You have to humble yourself and say, I need a Savior. I need a Redeemer. God wants to restore all of that hurt and all of that brokenness in your life. He wants to heal you. Spirit, soul, and body, He wants to redeem you. He wants to buy you back. Jesus said this in John 5:24. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. See, this is a promise that Jesus made. John 17:8, he says, for I have given to them. Now, John 17 is when Jesus is meeting with the Father while he's wrapping up his ministry. He's having a final meeting, prayer meeting. And it's a very intimate moment. And it's interesting to me what he and the Father, what he's talking to the Father about in this time of prayer. He could have talked about anything, but he knows he's going to the cross the next day, and he says, for I have given to them, his followers, his disciples, the words which you have given me. And they have received them and have known surely that I came forth from you. So whatever those words that Jesus gave from the Father, what it was to do was to convince his followers, 3.5 years it took, that Jesus came from God. And he goes on to say, and they have believed that you sent me. What do you believe about God? What do you believe about God? This is what Jesus spoke of, not just one time, like 3 or 4 times in this one chapter. He goes on to say in verse 25, O righteous Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you. And these have known that you sent me. That's a revelation you need to get. That God sent Jesus into the earth to die for your sins. That's a revelation Jesus spoke to the Father before going to the cross. He said, look, I've been with these guys for 3.5 years, and they finally get it. They finally know. They've received this word that I have given them. That you, Father, sent me into the world to be the Savior of the world. In John 17:20, Jesus says, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. That's you and me if we're believers. We've believed in Jesus from the disciples and the followers of Jesus in that day and time. That's how we came to believe. Jesus says, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, and they also may be one in us. You get all that? See, it's God's heart to have a family, and he wants you in it. He doesn't want you to come before the white throne of judgment. He wants you to be judged by Jesus. Because you know the gospel. That he came to be your redeemer. Is Jesus your redeemer? Have you made Jesus your redeemer? Hallelujah. But he goes on. He doesn't stop there in this verse. He talks about all of this oneness. But he talks about all of this oneness for a reason. Listen to what he goes on to say. That the world may believe that you sent me. that the world may believe. All of our oneness here in the body of Christ, what a wonderful worship session we had this morning. I was thinking about these verses and I was thinking, wow, what would it be like to be in this service if I was not a believer? I mean, what is an unbeliever sensing in this service? Oneness? See, Jesus said it like this. How you and I love one another is how the world is going to know about him. That's a real paraphrase there. The world is watching the oneness of the body of Christ. And when they see that, Jesus says, all of this oneness, that the world may believe that you sent me. Do you believe that God sent Jesus? See, I said this the last time I spoke. The devil is about deception. All he is trying to do is deceive you a little bit. He doesn't have to fully trick you. He just gets you deflected off of the truth. He's going to, just like Eve, he gave her partial truth, enough to deceive her, the Bible says. He just wants to deflect you from the truth, to throw you off. And so he came up with a plan about 150 years ago. I don't know when he came up with the plan, but I guess he executed it with this theory called evolution. Fooled the whole world. You can go in other countries around the world and they teach this theory as truth, as fact. But it's only a theory. But what this theory does is it says there is no God. There is no God. So what do you believe about God? And I said this before. If there is no God, then Jesus is irrelevant. He was just another man. But if there is a God, and Jesus spent 3.5 years teaching his disciples so that they would know that God sent him into the earth to be the Savior of the world. And that's what they were motivated about, to tell other people that God sent Jesus to be your Redeemer, to buy you back, to bring you into his family, so that you don't have to stand before the great white throne of judgment, that you can spend all eternity. God wants to give you everlasting life. But you have to reach out. You have to do something about it. You have to receive it. What do you believe about God? It was important to Jesus what his followers believed about God. It was important to him that they believed that God sent him into the world. We'll close on this. I got more to say, but we got to finish this if you want to come up here. Jesus said this. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So I would ask you, do you know what you believe? Are you believing in Jesus as your Savior? Do you believe that God sent Jesus into the earth to die for you? See, you have to humble yourself to believe that. You would have to say, I can't do this on my own. I need a Savior. Paul said it this way, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, he will certainly save us from God's condemnation. And that's, folks, that's what I'm trying to communicate to you today. If you don't know Jesus, God loves you. He wants to redeem you. He wants to buy you back from the brokenness that maybe your family has left you in. He's greater than all of the hurts that have been done to you. His healing can make you whole. He can make you whole. And you can be assured of where you're going to spend eternity. For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of His Son, while we were still His enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of His Son. See, God has put on the greatest love story ever to demonstrate to you how much He loves you. I like the song that says, how many kings have stepped down from their thrones? How many lords have abandoned their homes? How many greats have become the least for me? How many gods have poured out their hearts to romance a world that is torn all apart? How many fathers gave up their sons for me? Only one did that for me. Hallelujah. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. What do you believe? Can we stand, please? Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. I want you to picture God's love for you by His creation. And even when man fell, God made a way. God took it upon Himself to die for you, to redeem you, to buy you back, because He has a plan and a purpose for your life. But it's important what you believe. What do you believe about Jesus? What do you believe about Jesus? Take a second, ask yourself. Do you know that you know that you know that He's your Savior? Do you know you won't have to stand before the great white throne of judgment? Because Jesus has redeemed you and bought you back? I wish we had time to talk about what it means to be a believer, to be born again, to be born into God's family. There's a saying, if you're only born once, you will die twice. And that last death is to spend eternity in the lake of fire. But if you're born twice, your first physical birth, your second, you were born again into God's kingdom. Your spirit was born into God's family. Then you will only die once. Hallelujah. If you don't know Jesus as your Savior, as your Redeemer, I want you to pray this. Let's everyone pray this together. See, I believe that seeds are being planted. Father God, I thank You for sending Jesus. I believe that You sent Jesus to be my Redeemer, to die on the cross for my sins. I believe that He was resurrected from the dead and is alive with You in heaven now. Jesus, be my Savior. Jesus, redeem me. and show me your plans and your purposes for my life. I want to live for you, Lord. I want to put it all behind me. And I want to live for you. Hallelujah. The Bible says, with the heart, man believes. With the heart, man believes unto righteousness. And with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. If you prayed that prayer, I want you to tell somebody. I want you to tell somebody before the end of the day that you asked Jesus into your heart. Tell a friend. Tell someone in your family. And when you do, you will know that you know that you know that you've been born again. I want you to tell somebody that you prayed that prayer and you asked Jesus into your heart. Hallelujah.